yourself, so try not to mislead her. You've done many foolish things, but deep inside you need her.
As I was saying last week and this morning, this is the bit I've been looking forward to, because, and I'm sure you have too, because Gary Taylor is a very, very popular guitarist here on Curtain FM 100.1 and amongst the wider population, in fairness. In fairness, Gary, a very good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon, Mike.
Now, what I'm going to aim to try and do, which is an absolute impossibility, so I know I'm going to give up before I even start, is to go very briefly through your background, through your life, because I'm sure the listeners would want to know where Gary Taylor came from, and probably right at the end, where he's going. So not perhaps when you were a child, but the first professional group you played for was actually The Herd?
It was, yeah. The story about that, I was about 16, 16 and a half. I was in my bedroom playing the guitar. I was still at school at the time. Yeah,
whereabouts was this, town-wise?
This was in a place called Mulsey, which is very close to Hampton Court.
Oh, right, yep.
Just outside London.
London.
And one day a chap came to mend my mother's washing machine. And I was upstairs playing my guitar. And he must have heard me. And he mentioned to my mum that he was in a group and that they were looking for a lead guitar player. And organised for my dad to take me up for an audition, which was for a band called The Herd. And I got the job. And left school and joined The Herd.
How did your parents see that at that? Because that was quite a, I mean, 16-year-olds then, it's a very tender age.
Well, a very tender age, and also not very many people did that sort of thing in those days. We didn't even know anybody who knew anybody who was in show business, you know, at all. It wasn't a very popular decision at home, but you know, as I probably wasn't an academic genius, and I was musical, and I really, really wanted to do it, that's what happened.
Yeah.
And for the first, because it was just before the school summer holiday, so I was still at school when I joined The Herd. So,
And were the rest of The Herd fairly young at that time? Or were you the
Because
Peter Frampton was...
Well, he was... that was two or three years later.
Okay.
He joined. And he was also 16 and a half, I think, at the time. The oldest member of The Herd was, when I joined, was the drummer. He was about 22, 23.
Oh, an old man.
But his claim to fame was he was the original drummer of the Rolling Stones.
Oh.
Who sadly got chucked out and replaced by Charlie Watts.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was a rather bitter, man who was our first drummer. And eventually he left and we got another drummer.
And did the Herd get a recording contract early on, or was that much later? Because I can't remember, the double CD doesn't give the years, oddly enough, of
well, most of that was recorded in about 1967. We'd made a couple of records earlier than that, which nothing came of. And it wasn't until we'd had a residency in a club called The Marquee in London, which was a very famous club where a lot of people like Eric Clapton, Jimi Hendrix, bands like The Move, Manfred Mann were playing. And we got a residency there on a Saturday night. And an American guy called Steve Roland, who was a record producer, came and saw us. And he was at the time recording Dave D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick and Titch.
Oh, yes, yes.
And he thought he'd like to record us as well. And our first workings with him, actually, were doing demos for Dave D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick and Titch. And eventually, I think probably one of the first hit records that I was on was in about 1966 when Zabadak came out. I don't know whether you remember that.
I do, indeed.
And I was the bloke that went, Zabadak.
And that really?
Yeah, yeah. That was my first hit record. I'm sure you've got to start somewhere. Yeah. And they were managed by a couple of guys called Ken Howard and Adam Blakely, who became the Hearns managers. And they wrote our first hit, which was called From the Underworld.
Yes, that's on the system here. I was going to play that, but because that's been played so often, I thought I'd play something different. So the Hearns appeared on TV because there's a YouTube video of you with the Hearns on. So was that sort of Top of the Pops or something?
No, it wasn't. Well, the first TV show we did was the Simon D Show.
All right, yes.
In about 1967, I think. And in those days, I mean, there weren't nearly the amount of pop groups around that there are now. So if you appeared on television, you became very well known, like the day after.
Yes.
So our lives changed dramatically from that first TV show. The one that's on YouTube, they come from a show called Beat Club, which was recorded in Bremerhaven in Germany. And everybody did that show. It involved getting on a boat and travelling overnight to Bremerhaven, doing the show, and then coming back on the boat the next day. It was great.
Only you can help yourself, so try not to mislead her. You've done many foolish things, but deep inside you need things, but deep inside you need her. 'Cause baby, though you know I'll never leave you, never wanted to deceive you, although I do. But I don't want our loving to die, and I'm so tired of living.
So, what happened to the? I mean, the herd are no more. We know that. What happened to them? Did it just peter out, or did people move on to? I mean,
well, Peter Frampton left first of all, and we carried on as a three piece for a while. Our drummer then got ill, and we got another drummer and carried on for a little while longer. It was going nowhere. We put out one record, which didn't do anything. And I, in the meantime, I got an offer to join the BBC as a disc jockey. So I thought, well, I'll give that a go. So when the herd actually fell apart, which is in about 1969, I joined the BBC as a Radio 1 disc jockey, which I did for about 3 years.
Where did your appearance, several recordings with Jerry Rafferty fit in? Is that prior to this?
No, that happened in about 1970. Funnily enough, about 1970, 71. Funnily enough, I was doing a BBC show called What's New, which reviewed all the records that came out in any given week. It was a 5 o'clock till 6 o'clock show. And I played a track off an LP from a band called the Humble Bums, which featured people I'd never heard of before, a Scottish guy called Billy Connolly.
Yes.
And Jerry Rafferty. A strange album because they didn't do anything together. They each had their own separate tracks, as it were. And I played a song that was called Shoeshine Boy, and it blew me away. I thought, this is really, really good. And I gave it a great review. Jerry Rafferty. And a friend of mine, a record producer called Hugh Murphy, who I'd done some sessions, was doing some sessions for various other artists, got this Scottish guy called Jerry Rafferty to produce. And so I met Jerry, and I wound up being his session bass player, as it were. This was in about 1970, 1971, I can't remember. So that was the beginning of my musical relationship with Jerry Rafferty.
And was the BBC, because you did lots of other things with, I mean, you were a disc jockey with the BBC, and of course, a lot of our listeners, of course, come from sort of the UK, and you did, I believe, Listen with Mother.
Yes. Now, this was a program I used to listen to when I was a very small child, and loved. It had this great catchphrase, because they used to sing nursery rhymes and tell stories. Before the story started, the storyteller would always say, "Are you sitting comfortably? Then I'll begin." And
yes.
George had a terrible headache. And you launch on with your story. And I wound up, I got asked to audition to present it, and I wound up doing it for 10 years until it ended. Yeah. I'm working with, the first lady I worked with, Gladys Whitridge. Her claim to fame was that she was the voice of weed in the Flower Pot Men.
Oh, they're my heroes.
Oh, yeah,
they truly are.
Who was the other one? Neris Hughes, who was in a series called The Liver Birds. She was my other partner on Listen With Mother. I loved doing that. I loved it. It was great fun.
So you were with the BBC for...
From about 69 until about 1984.
And was that a good organisation to work for? You go in, you do your bit, and you go home, sort of thing?
You'd go in, you do your bit, and you go home. As a Radio 1 disc jockey, certainly. Yes, you went in, you did your show all by yourself, and you went home, picked up your box of records for the next day, and then you went home, didn't see anybody, didn't know who was listening, although there was a big listenership in those days.
Oh, huge, Radio 1.
6 million or something
yes,
like that.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
It was huge. Doing Listen With Mother, no, there was a whole production team behind that, so that was a much more social thing.
And that, of course, was that recorded, whereas the disc jockey bit was live?
Disc jockey bit was live. Listen With Mother was recorded. We did five programmes in a day, basically, 5 quarter-hour programmes. It was a laugh. It was good fun.
And then, was that after that you moved to Australia?
Moved to Australia emigrated in 1989. Yeah.
And that was almost straight for the BBC, or was there something in between?
Well, at the same time as doing the BBC thing, I was doing a lot of sessions.
Right.
As a bass player.
Who did you work with there?
Oh, gee. Well, the thing about doing sessions is that you work with a lot of people that you've never necessarily heard of, and most of the stuff that you play on, you never hear again. I was in another band in the mid-70s called Fox, for a while. We had a couple of big hits. One that gets played over here quite a lot, Single Bed. Do you remember that?
No, I don't remember that one. I'll have to look that one up.
People like I did some sessions with Jerry Lee Lewis, for example. Dennis Roussos. I really can't remember. Most of them were anonymous because, as I say, a lot of the stuff you do never sees the light of day.
Yeah, and I understand from the session musicians I've spoken to, the rates of pay are pretty appalling.
I remember
talking to Vic Flick, who did the James Bond theme, and for that he got £7.10. That was it. Boom.
Oh, sure.
A one-off payment. Sure.
That's right. I think the session fee, my first session fee, was £9, I think. Mm. That's what he got for a three-hour session. But then again, it was worth a lot.
I was going to say, in those days, you could buy a Rolls Royce, have a lunch, and well, yeah, I know, yeah. So, you moved to Australia. Why did you move here? Was it a family-orientated move?
Partly family-orientated. The session worker dropped off a lot during the 80s. Mm. Synthesizers had taken over from bass players a lot. And also, a younger crop of musicians was coming through. So the work had sort of disappeared. A lot of my family had emigrated here, and I'd been over to visit a few times. Eventually, got offered a job to work in a recording studio. And so I came out and worked for a guy called Kevin Peake, who was doing a lot of jingles.
He was part of Sky. Yes.
Yeah, playing second classical guitar to John Williams in Sky on the throne. But had a flourishing jingle business here. And also, when I first came out, I did a lot of voiceover work here. In the days when you could sell a voice like mine.
Well, of course, you know. The listeners will know your voice because you do a lot of community service announcement work for us.
Yeah, I did a few of those. But I had a lot of voiceover work in the
This is for advertisements?
Eventually, Kevin Peake got out of the jingle business, and I sort of inherited his client list and became a jingle writer, which is what I did for most of the 90s.
Still playing a guitar at the same time? Or did that fall to the side a little?
It fell to the side a bit. Became a kind of keyboard player. And when I say kind of keyboard player, I mean one that was connected to a computer, so I could play stuff badly and correct it. which you can do on a computer.
Yes, yes.
Became mainly a keyboard. And the bass dropped off a bit as well. Until I bumped into Hank Marvin. In about 1993, 94, and he was living here in Perth, and asked me to play bass on a CD he was making called Hank Plays Cliff. And that was the beginning of a musical relationship.
And we know you're still playing with the Hank Marvin Gypsy Jazz Quartet. We'll come to that in the second part. But to take us up to the sponsorship break, could you perhaps introduce us to that particular track because it's brand new and it's a privilege to say that this will be the first time ever it has gone out over the airwaves.
Yes, it is.
It's brand new.
It's a tune that I heard that actually I didn't know that Hank had recorded, but he did, because I checked it out yesterday and listened to his version on YouTube, which I hadn't heard before I did my version.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah. I just heard the tune and sort of did it from memory, as it were. And it evokes, I think, probably visions of Hawaii, perhaps. So although it's pouring with rain outside at the moment, imagine yourself on a Hawaiian beach, looking out over the ocean, hula girls around you. It's called Waheen.
And here it is, the first ever time it's been aired.
Thank you.
Elohim by me.
Yes, and now we were talking earlier on and just starting to introduce your work with the Hank Marvin Gypsy Jazz Quartet. Perhaps you could tell us a little of that and of the fact that you're working in the studio at the moment with the possibility of another...
Yes, we're making a new album virtually as we speak. We started about 2 weeks ago. It's another month or so to go, I imagine. But yes, we're doing a new Gypsy album.
And there's a tour possible?
Yes, coming up in November. I think we're going to do the Fly By Night Club in Fremantle early in November. And then later in November, we're going to New Zealand to do half a dozen gigs there. And then doing a small tour of the eastern states after that.
Now, between you and I, because no one's listening, this is just a private conversation. I mean, I have had the privilege of meeting Hank. What's Hank like to work with? Is he as nice as...
Oh, it's dreadful. No, he's delightful to work with, absolutely delightful. I've been working with him now for about, 20 years or so.
Really?
Well, since 1994. Mm. I've done a whole heap of albums together.
And he's improved over that time.
He's got better.
Yeah.
He has.
Yeah.
And it was while we were making, in about 2002, I think it was, the Guitar Player album, that he came in with a cassette of Django Reinhardt and said, "I'm really into this. I really have a listen to this." And I listened to a bit of Django Reinhardt, and I'd never really liked very much of what I'd heard of him before, mainly because all the records sounded so scratchy and old. But when you actually listen through the scratches, as it were, you could tell how brilliant the man was and why he was such an influence on so many guitarists. And Hank and I started trying in those early days to emulate some of this, and it sort of we got more and more and more into it, and we've been doing that now for
not being
10 years.
Not being a musician and not being able to know which end of a guitar to even pick up, is it do you almost have to relearn a different style?
Well, in this case, yes, it was quite an education, really, because you use different chord shapes, certainly from a rhythm guitar point of view, which is what I do in this particular band. It's a lot of it's very energetic, very fast, and I simply couldn't do it. When I first tried to play some Gypsy rhythm, as it were, I could do it for about 30 seconds and my arm begin to fall off. It was really, really difficult. And you begin to develop a technique and a knack after a while.
Yes. I've seen you with the Gypsy Jazz Quartet live a couple of times now, and it seems as if the band have a lot of fun in playing.
Oh,
that's what sort of comes out. Now, whether I'm not going to ask whether that's an act or not, because showbiz
is
a showbiz.
It isn't.
But it really isn't.
No. It is fun. We wouldn't do it. It's too hard a work, actually.
Mm.
We put a lot of effort into rehearsals and stuff. And hopefully that shows what... Hopefully that shows in the performances.
And of course you play in smaller, more intimate places, don't you? I mean, you don't play in Shea Stadium, is that sort of out nowadays?
It's not a stadium act.
No.
It's simply not. And I think Hank much prefers, it's certainly in this genre of music, playing more intimate venues. So we tend to play sort of, at the most, 500, 600 seaters.
Mm.
Or smaller, even. Mm. It lends itself to that kind of intimacy, I suppose.
Yeah, and as I say, the group of you always see, and your accordionist, always seems to, Nunzio always seems to be having a great deal of fun there.
He does. He's great, Nunzio. Yeah. He's a great player.
Well, we're going to hear a track from that in just a few seconds, but before I do, I know you're going to kick... Well, I don't think your feet
can reach
me under the table. Oh, that's good. I'm protected until Gary leaves the studio, because I'm going to put you on the spot. You know I am.
Yeah.
There's so many listeners out there for Curtain 100.1 are desperately waiting for this new CD. So come
on. I know. Well, what happened was I lived in this lovely little old house in North Beach. It's getting rather old and falling to bits, a bit like me. And it came to the time when the landlord had to knock it down. So I became Homeless. and I'm staying with my sister at the moment and looking for a reasonably priced rental in the same sort of area.
So what you're saying is this is all Mary's fault?
It's all Mary's fault. Yes, yeah. All Mary's fault. Yeah. So it sort of slowed down the recording process just a little.
Right, $64,000 question.
What, when?
Yeah.
When? Well, hopefully, getting there slowly, believe it or
what
not.
What do you mean by getting there? Because 18 months ago.
Yeah, I know, I lied, didn't I?
Before Christmas?
This year, definitely. Couple of months, I would say.
Well, let me know.
Bearing in mind, I've got two albums on the go at the moment, this one and the next one, you know, so a bit of sympathy, you know.
But that takes care of Monday and Tuesday. What? I mean, okay. So we look forward to that, and of course, we'll be announcing it here and playing it, of course. Perhaps you would like to introduce the tune from Hank Marvin's Gypsy Jazz Quartet that we're going to play you out with.
Well, this is the title track from the album. It's called Django's Castle.
Okay. Thank you so much, Gary.
Great pleasure. Thank you.
Bye-bye.